Hello everyone, good evening, good morning. I'm Sireesha Yadlapalli and I welcome you all to another episode of USP COVID Connect. Through this series, we have been speaking to various leaders and experts in the pharmaceutical and healthcare sector. We gather fresh insights on the challenges as well as potential solutions and best practices with respect to COVID-19. Today, we are very happy to welcome back Dr. Gagandeep Kang, Professor and Head of Wellcome Trust Research Laboratory at CMC Vellore. Dr. Kang has spoken to our audience in an earlier episode of USP COVID Connect. We also welcome Dr. Geetha Prasadini, Director of Public Health and Family Welfare, Government of Andhra Pradesh. Dr. Kang, with decades of experience in vaccines, is known for her interdisciplinary research studying the transmission, development, and prevention of enteric infections in children in India. To develop practical approaches to support public health, Dr. Kang has also built various national rotavirus and typhoid surveillance networks. She's established laboratories to support clinical trials and conducted phase 1 to 3 clinical trials of vaccines, a comprehensive approach that has supported 2 WHO pre-qualified vaccines made by 2 Indian companies. She's seeking to build stronger human immunology research in India. Based at CMC Vellore, she has established strong training programs for students and young faculty in clinical transitional medicine, aiming to build a cadre of clinical researchers studying relevant problems in India. Welcome, Dr. Kang. Our next speaker, Dr. Geetha Prasadini, is the current Director of Public Health and Family Welfare, Government of Andhra Pradesh. She's also a gynecologist and obstetrician. She has 38 years of experience in the public health department. Before becoming director, she was the state level nodal officer for maternal and child health, communicable and non-communicable diseases, and integrated disease surveillance program. She's managed various public health emergencies in the state, swine flu, dengue, lead poisoning, and currently the COVID-19 pandemic. Recently, under her guidance, the state has completed 13.9 lakh vaccinations on a single day, the highest in the country. Her rich experience in implementing programs for communicable diseases, vaccinations, establishing IDSP labs and coordinating with stakeholders like CDC, WHO, and extensive experience in engaging frontline public health workforce is most relevant for today's topic. Welcome, Dr. Geetha. So without further delay, I'll get to the first question for today's discussion. So India has seen several hugely successful immunization programs and has planned strategy to carry out these programs at the national level. I want our audience to hear from both of you today on the collective experience we have from running these programs. So maybe we could start with Dr. Geetha. So at the administration level, Dr. Geetha, could you share what are the typical challenges of a universal immunization program in terms of infrastructure or logistics or capability building? If you could elaborate on the typical challenges, that would be great.
Sure, Rama, you're welcome. And the main challenges in the universal immunization program, in the beginning of this universal immunization, we used to have the challenges at the time of infrastructure. Regarding the establishing the cold chain points and then the logistics and the where we have to get the vaccine and all these things, we started this UAP program. But in our state of Andhra Pradesh, now we didn't have any of this problems. Now we are having sufficient cold chain points for even at the every PHC where we are rendering the services for the 30,000 to 50,000 population. And then even at the sub-center level also, where we have established these cold chain points for the storaging. And the logistic point of view, we used to have a very good system of the storage from the state level to regional level. From the regional level to, we are having the DVC, that is district vaccination centers. From there, we used to have the PHCs. And again to the CCPs. So regarding that, one more challenge is, you know, now and then everybody knows after the inception of the universal immunization program at 1985, we used to got so many new vaccines in the middle, so up to this time. At that time, capacity building, that is the, who are the workers, vaccinators who are on a continuous training of them. That is also one of the hurdle what we faced at the time. But any vaccine is when we are introducing into the public domain, then we have to give the capacity building of the all the frontline workers, we are going to have the vaccination. But in this COVID era, now we are able to do this startup training, keeping in view of the COVID. We are now also we are arranged all these trainings for our vaccinators by virtual trainings. We are now not able to take up the physical trainings, but we are able to do the virtual training for before the vaccination. These are the some of the things for any universal program what you are running. These are the main challenges. But we have, in our state, we didn't have the resources, and everything is adequate. For that reason only, we have doing this COVID-19 vaccination in the same pace like that, without having any much difficulties.
So from an infrastructure standpoint and logistics standpoint, you're saying a lot has been eased, yes, in the usual immunization. Okay, great, thank you.
Yeah.
Dr. Kang, from a policy standpoint, what are the typical challenges for a UIP program at the scale that India usually does these programs?
Well, I think the first policy challenge is really around the decision to introduce a vaccine. And in order to do that, the elements that need to be considered is whether there is sufficient burden of disease to warrant introduction of a vaccine for the entire population or for a population of interest. Then you need to know that there are vaccines that work and the efficacy of that vaccine is sufficient to for you to be reasonably confident that it will alleviate a significant proportion of the burden of disease. And the third component is that the vaccination program needs to be ready and able to deliver the vaccine. So all the challenges that Dr. Geetha just spoke about in terms of infrastructure, in terms of human resources, all of those need to be prepared before a vaccine is introduced. So those are policy challenges with making the decision to introduce. And then you have to think about whether you want to introduce countrywide or you want to introduce in specific areas, what your justification is for that. Currently, of course, for COVID-19, we have an additional challenge, which is a shortage of supply. So that results in the need to prioritize and make decisions about who needs to get vaccine first and why. So right now, the decision making, everyone's aware of what the prioritization framework is. It's one that WHO has also aligned with and was actually the first group to develop. But now there are discussions about whether we should be changing policy, because with this policy was designed for an old version of the virus. Now we've got a virus that is behaving differently. So should we be thinking about a different structure to our immunization? The challenges don't stop.
That's very useful. So when you were very much part of the rotavirus, get as part of the, you know, getting into the immunization program. So from then to now, in terms of being able to add something to UIP program, is it similar or are the challenges different each time?
So rotavirus was the last vaccine that was introduced countrywide into the routine immunization program. And before the rotavirus vaccine was introduced, there was an assessment of the cold chain, and some states had gaps that needed to be addressed. In addition to that, India was at that time building the electronic vaccine information network that has now morphed into the COVID-like structure. So a lot of things were changed for rotavirus. And this year, we are going to be expanding pneumococcal vaccine by the end of the year to every state in this country. So then our children will be getting vaccines comparable to vaccines that are received by children in many developed parts of the world. So I think what we have done with the immunization program is built capacity for new vaccine introduction. And again, as Dr. Geetha said, the infrastructure is there, the people are there, the constant training to which she referred is an essential component of us being able to bring in new vaccines. So I think if I talk about what has changed, it's the level of preparedness. I think we've just become a much better program over the last 5 years.
That is so reassuring to hear. That's fantastic. So that brings me to our next question. So given all of this preparation, and you mentioned cold chains, and there were gaps in some states, and we filled those gaps, what is the situation with the COVID vaccination drive in the country today? Maybe we start with Andhra Pradesh and ask Dr. Geetha, where is the drive today, and what are the lessons that we have learned from the universal immunization program that have been applied to the COVID vaccination drive?
This is somewhat a very important thing, huh? What we learned from the UIP, the lessons what you have learned, and how best we can use those lessons to implement the COVID-19 vaccination. What are those, what we have planned, and the meticulous planning also. Whenever we are having the micro planning of routine immunization, because the universal immunization, as everyone knows, it started long back. It is a systematic customized training and UIP program where we used to get all the vaccines at the time, in time, and we used to regularly vaccinate the people in specific schedule. In every state, we used to have 1 day is a fixed routine vaccination program in the UIP on every Wednesday. Is at the site, and every Saturday is the outreach. That is the thing. That is the systematic planning and the micro planning where we have to do. That always helps us in connecting now the COVID-19 vaccine. In the COVID-19 vaccine, the people are different. As knows everybody, when we started this program on January 16th for the implementation of COVID-19 vaccine, and the beneficiaries are almost at the other end of the ages, and they are all given for the, at the time the decision, Ministry of Health has taken a decision to give the vaccination for the frontline workers. In the compare with the UIP, the most of the vaccines are more dealt for the pediatric age group, up to 11 like that, 12 like that. And then COVID vaccination, when we started, is a large campaign. First time at the time. That is the lesson what we have learned day by day when we are doing the vaccination for the COVID. So many things, what the planning of this thing and meticulous planning, and then continuous administration and the capacity building of the ANMs who are the vaccinators at the field level. All these things, the lessons what we have learned from UIP is very, very useful and in implementing the COVID vaccination in a successful way. But now in Andhra Pradesh, COVID-19 vaccine, already we have covered more than 1 crore people, 1 crore 17 lakhs people as on today. By then, that is means 1/5 of our population is already covered. And I think in India also, it is 33 crores, 50 lakhs was covered in India all. And the AP is having, this is as per the guidelines, the first, when the vaccination has started in a phase-wise manner, in the beginning we have covered the frontline HCW, that is healthcare workers. Then we shifted to frontline workers. Then again we have gone to the 60 plus. After that we have taken into the phase 4 is the 45 plus with comorbids and without comorbids also. Now the government of India is open up the vaccination for the 18 to 44 age group. In that also, keeping in view of the availability of the vaccine, now we, as a, in the Andhra Pradesh government, now we are focusing for the mothers who are having less than five children, less than 5 years children. Keeping someone, as everybody knows, everybody is telling the third wave may come, and it affects mostly the children. For that sake, as on 18 to 44 age group also, now we are focusing for the mothers who are having less than 5 years children. Like that, in state of Andhra Pradesh, the COVID-19 vaccination is going in a smooth way.
Thank you, Dr. Geetha. That was a lot of good information. So in summary, all of the planning preparation that was very systematic because of the how we did the UIP programs basically helped in the COVID drive, the vaccination drive. Now, there were issues related to availability, there are issues related to the rollout itself, and maybe even some vaccine hesitancy that you may have come across. So amongst these three, vaccine availability, hesitancy, and rollout, where were challenges in the last 3 months, maybe, or last 4 or 5 months versus right now? So what are the challenges that were there last 3 or 4 months? And today, what do you face as a challenge?
In the beginning, what you are telling me, the first one is the vaccine availability is there, but at the time we have faced the vaccine hesitancy because it's a new vaccine and the people, the beneficiaries are not able to come what we have for the expectations. So immediately after the new vaccine has come and everybody thought of it is in trials, something like that, the hesitancy has got a first thing when the vaccination was started in the month of January. After that, what we have noticed, the lesson what we learned, and everyone, when we started to getting the frontline workers, all the eminent doctors and the professors who are working in the medical colleges and the people working in the medicine, medical field, they have taken first and they become the role model. And they have proved that self, nothing will happen if you take the vaccine also. Like that, with a lot of IEC campaign and the BCC campaign, and not only that, creating awareness in the people, that is the what are the benefits if you take the vaccine. Like that, the hesitancy has come down, so many beneficiaries coming forward now to have it vaccination on their own. Without we are having the mobilization also, they are coming on their own to have vaccination. That is the number one. Number two is the vaccine availability. It should be continuous vaccine supply should be there. In the beginning, we used to get so much, a very minimum vaccine, and then beneficiaries also. Now we want to have, that is the vaccine availability. Continuous supply of vaccine availability should be there to cope up. Now we are able to cross that also. Recently, what our state is receiving once in a week or twice in a week, now we are getting the both Covaxin and Covishield. And one more thing, when the beginning, everybody wants to have Covaxin only for the reasons. But after that, because of our creating awareness that both are same and the duration and the efficacy, what are the things, what then the people are coming now for the both vaccines. Now the acceptability of both Covaxin and Covishield is also there in our state.
So vaccine hesitancy that you've seen in the first few months has been overcome to a great extent, you feel, and the supply issue is also easing and you're able to get more supply. So those are all wonderful news to hear. I'm sure that's reassuring to a lot of our audience as well. My last question on this rollout is, Dr. Geetha, the scale at which India does immunization programs is probably much larger than any place else, even for our regular vaccine immunization programs. But with COVID-19, the scale at which India has to achieve vaccination to 70% is huge. So what specific issues do you see because of the scale of operations?
Not much what the difference, okay, that or not, there is no nothing much what I have seen. That is, the rollout is also becoming easy also because of our meticulous planning and the interdepartmental coordination and the micro planning also.
Great, thank you. Dr. Kang, switching to policy level for a similar question, coming to COVID-19 vaccination drive, what is the situation today at a policy level? What do you think are challenges and what can be improved?
Right now, at the policy level in India, we have multiple groups that are engaged in developing the policy and then overseeing it. So what has been in existence for a really long time is the National Technical Advisory Group on Immunizations. And it's important to emphasize that the NTAGI, which is a body that WHO requires to exist in every country, they call the NITAG elsewhere, for National Immunization Technical Advisory Group, has been in existence in India for about 20 years. And it was reshaped in the early 2010s and has functioned to review and make decisions on the introductions of new vaccines. In other countries, it is involved in the programs also, and how programs are implemented, what decisions are made around that. In India, the NTAGI has been largely limited to just making decisions on introduction of new vaccines. So when COVID-19 came around, a working group was established for COVID-19 specifically. The group is chaired by Dr. Narendra Arora, who is, I think, president of INCLEN, which is the International Clinical Epidemiology Network. He used to be a pediatric professor at AIMS. He's been very involved with many vaccine things. He chairs the meeting, and he's also a member of another committee. It's called NEGVAC, this national expert group for, I think, of vaccine administration. And that is chaired by Dr. Vinod Paul, who is the member health Niti Aayog. So NEGVAC is supposed to make the decisions about the actual vaccine administration, whereas the role of NTAGI has been around things like the dose interval between vaccines and whether or not a vaccine should be introduced, and also on what the priority groups should be. So sometimes, you know, NTAGI can recommend, but NEGVAC does not necessarily need to accept that recommendation. NTAGI, it's very important to emphasize, is an advisory body and has no executive function, whereas NEGVAC consists mostly of government officials, and they are the ones who make the decisions about how implementation and administration will take place. So different aspects of policy looked after differently.
Thank you, Dr. Kang. So that is probably a detail that a lot of our audience is not very aware of. So we're not aware of the structures of how these decisions get made. So it appears that it's a little complex the way we are structured in India, because there is not a single body or a committee in charge of everything. And there are multiple advisory bodies or multiple committees where these decisions are being made. And there's been so much discussion on, you know, whether it's the interval between the two doses of COVID shield, or whether it is just various aspects of how eligibility is being decided on who's eligible for vaccine when. And the second wave has really exaggerated the kind of conversations we've been having in the country. So it's useful to know where these could be improved and what can be improved at a policy level so that the vaccination drive is faster and more successful in India.
Oh, absolutely. So I think in other countries where you have expert advisory groups, you actually don't need the multiple additional structures that have been created. So for example, if the Joint Committee on Vaccinations and Immunizations in the UK makes a recommendation, it's taken for granted that the recommendations will be accepted by the UK government because the UK government established this body. Similarly, for the American Committee on Immunization Practices, which is housed at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, when the ACIP makes a recommendation, and again, its members are made up, while the secretariat is in a government organization, the CDC, the members of ACIP are actually independent, and they vote to make recommendations. And it's dependent on their votes that recommendations are made. But once they are made by ACIP, they are binding, including to the point of insurance facilities needing to pay, you know, HMOs needing to provide the vaccines, insurance coming under the National Vaccine Injury Prevention Act to make sure that compensation is paid. So in most countries, it is this advisory group that kind of gives advice on policy after appropriate review, and it's accepted by government. And I'm also chair of the Immunization Technical Advisory Group for Southeast Asia for WHO. So I get to see the all 11 countries of CF operating. And there are other countries also where the advisory group is not independent, is not the single group. Sri Lanka, for example, their committee is entirely made up of government officials, but they get informed by scientists. So I think there is a variation in how different countries operate. And I guess the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare must think that this approach is the best approach for India. But it can be a little difficult sometimes when the science points in one direction and the policy goes in another direction.
So I'll ask the same question I asked Dr. Geetha. So from a policy standpoint, between vaccine availability, rollout, and hesitancy, where do you think more of the challenges are that need to be addressed at a policy level?
I think the current challenge is supply, and policy is not going to be able to ramp up supply in the short term. What needed to be done in terms of investing in companies or making purchase agreements should have been done a while ago. Now some investments have been made, and we hope that supplies will improve in the latter half of this year. It's already evident that supplies are improving. We were able to give over about 150 million doses of vaccines in June, which is the best we've done so far. The fact that last Monday we were able to deliver 8.5 million doses of vaccine shows that the capacity to deliver vaccines exists. If there was enough supply, we could ramp up. But, you know, changing policy today will ramp up supply next year. Hesitancy, I think, is a problem of tomorrow. Because right now, from what Dr. Geetha said, there was an initial reluctance because people were worried about vaccine safety. Were these vaccines tested adequately? And now people are more eager to get the vaccines, but the supply is insufficient. But I think once you've finished about 60-70% of the population, we are going to come up against hesitancy again. Because there are people who have been given a lot of misinformation, disinformation on WhatsApp, on all kinds of discussions and different forms of social media. There is information being circulated that actually sounds very plausible, sounds very scientific, but it isn't. And to counter that is very challenging. because you need to be able to tailor your conversations to the community that you're dealing with, the group within that community that you're dealing with. You have to understand what their concerns are. You have to listen to them, and you have to be able to convey information, but not push them to make a decision. Like, for example, one thing that happens in our tribal areas quite frequently is that people are told, if you're coming to the ration shop, you're not going to get the TDS supply unless you've been vaccinated. Go bring your Aadhaar card, get the vaccine, then we'll give you your rice and sugar, right? That works for some people, but doesn't work for the bulk of people. So I think the messaging, the communication is something we need to start paying attention to. Because with this vaccine, remember, this is adult vaccination. With childhood vaccination, we managed to get to 90% coverage after 30 years of building the program. Now we want 85% coverage to be able to reach herd immunity. But 85% coverage of the whole population means that every adult needs to be vaccinated, because right now we don't have vaccine for under 18s. So how are you going to reach every adult? That is going to be very, very difficult.
Excellent. So supply continues to be the bigger issue at the moment. And given that supply is the bigger constraint at the moment, it brings me to the next question of vaccine wastage. So we really cannot, usually itself, we shouldn't, we should look at how to minimize wastage. But in a supply constraint environment globally on vaccines, and certainly in India, we have to do everything in our power to reduce the wastage of vaccines. So I wanted to understand from both of you, and maybe with Dr. Geetha first, how is wastage, the concept, handled during universal immunization program, even before we talk about COVID vaccines? How is this concept thought about? What are the trends about vaccine wastage? How are they handled and minimized during the immunization programs in general, Dr. Geetha?
Yeah, what you are asking for the wastage of the vaccine regarding in the universal immunization program also, what I told in the beginning also, this is only the micro planning and the supply of the vaccine in time. At the UIP, we never crossed the problem of deficiency of the vaccination. Always the vaccine is sufficient to vaccinate all the people. There is no vaccines not available at any time. And not only that, we are having a fixed schedule on the days where we have done. And we also know that who are the people, what they are going to, when they are going to get the vaccine in advance. And we intimate them also. Even in the UIP also, the children, we are having a system of ASHA and ANM. They know who is the waiting list, who are the due list for this week, where we have to do the vaccination for the children. Like that, we used to inform them in advance to get them vaccinated. Like that also, we have taken the care of not to have the wastage much. And one more thing, what we observed from this thing in the universal immunization program, we used to have the open vial policy. That is, the vaccine, when it is open, it can be used for some other time. Like that also, we used to minimize the vaccine. Compare with the COVID vaccine, when we are having we didn't have that. The vaccine is the WHO guidelines are like that. When we open the vial, we have to discard after 4 hours after the vaccine vial is opened. In the COVID vaccine also, what we have done in the state of Andhra Pradesh is a meticulous planning. And like that, we have, what we observed in the beginning is the you have noticed the wastage is more in our state of Andhra Pradesh. But after lessons, what you learned from the beginning and now what we are adapting is the quite a different one. Now we have given the instruction for the vaccinators. We have to open a vial when it was the people are beneficiaries are more than 8 to 9 people. Like that we have done. And one more the thing, the state of Andhra Pradesh is the where we are having a village level and ward secretariat system is there. where we are having one ANM is with us in the village secretariat and ward secretariat. One volunteer is also like that. So in advance, whenever we are planning for any campaign or vaccination regarding the COVID, we used to intimate the beneficiaries one day in advance by giving them some time slots. Because of COVID, we don't want to have the much congregation of the people, and the waiting time is also to be minimized. Even when the summer is peak also, then we have developed this, all these things. So we intimate beneficiaries in advance by giving their token system and timing. Yes, we want to give them slip at this time and the token, then you have to come and get vaccinated. Like that, we have taken the so much of precautions. Asha and ANM is also trained in such a way. They know the persons in name, by name also they know them. So who are eligible for that slot, we used to call them at that time. And then we have opened that vial and we have vaccinated as per the schedule. That means the 10 doses are like that. So like that also we have minimized the vaccination. And then in the UIP also, that is the only meticulous and the interdepartmental coordination. In state of Andhra Pradesh, we have taken the other departments who are working with us. That is especially the Women and Child Department, the Municipal Administration, and the administration at the district level, where we are having the joint collector who is looking after the health policy, all health also. Like that, with their guidance and our this thing also, we planned in such a way, there is a maximum coverage and minimum wastage. That is our ultimate this thing. We focused in such a way, we want to cover as maximum as the people with minimum wastage. Now our wastage, the AP state wastage has come down very much, so less than 2% or something like that. These are the steps taken by the state of Andhra Pradesh.
So it was quite concerning when we saw over 4 million dose wastage across the country by April timeframe, especially because the supplies were not robust yet. So it's really good to know, Dr. Geetha, that there were analysis and understanding of what led to that sort of very high wastage in the initial parts of the vaccination program, COVID vaccination drive. And that they're being addressed at the field level through all of these different tactics, right? So it would be great to see that number come down, as you're saying. Thank you so much. So Dr. Kang, switching to policy level discussion on wastage, what do you think generally for UIP, the trend is on expectation on wastage, ideas to minimize wastage, and how does it relate to the COVID vaccination drive, COVID policy, COVID vaccination policy in India?
I think Dr. Geetha has already highlighted what's done in the UIP in terms of having an open vial policy and the approaches that they have taken to make sure that every vial is fully utilized. Now, if you wanted to have absolutely no wastage at all, or minimal wastage, the best way to do it is not to have multi-dose vials, just have a single-dose vial for everything. But the problem with single-dose vials is that it greatly increases the cost of your vaccine and it increases the amount of cold chain space that is required for the storage of the vaccine. So you have to always balance how many doses you can get into a vial, which drives down cost, versus the question of wastage. So in the UIP, usually 10% wastage is considered okay. You begin to worry if the program or parts of the program have a wastage of higher than 10%. So by that account, SARS-CoV-2 vaccination is doing really, really well, because we've managed to push down wastage, even managed to extract extra doses out of multi-dose vials. So I think we are doing a reasonable job with wastage, but it's something that you need to keep your eye on. And from a policy level, ensuring that there is a tracking of wastage and looking at best practice across states is always helpful. So Kerala was the first state that gave more vaccinations than the number of doses received. So that is something that I think other states could look at emulating and would certainly also drive down their wastage rates. But it's also important to remember that not every state has the kind of dense population that Kerala has. So their being able to gather enough people for an immunization session is easier than, let's say, in a remote part of Andhra Pradesh.
Thank you, Dr. Kang. We've seen some very heartwarming videos on social media with ASHA workers carrying the vaccine boxes and crossing rivers and little lakes and trying to get to very, very remote parts. So kudos to all the frontline workers and ASHA workers and the program administrators for trying to do this. And I would assume that in a place like that, if you're trying to get every dose out of the vial, you may not be able to have enough people to give it to. So that makes sense. So now, continuing on the topic of vaccine wastage, we wanted to bring up the concept of the open vial, and Dr. Geetha was referring to it earlier on the number of hours the vial is considered viable. So each time the government introduces a new vaccine, there is a guidance on vaccine administration and how to handle the open vials, which is essentially reuse of partially used multi-dose vials of applicable vaccines within a recommended timeline. So this we understand is specific and differs for each vaccine based on the manufacturing and stability data available for that vaccine. So whether it is for the immunization program or for COVID, this is how we understand the decisions are based. But for COVID, we know that the manufacturing data submitted has actually supported 6 hours. However, the decision for COVID vaccine has been made to 4 hours. So we were wondering the possibility of extending time of the open vial from 4 to 6 hours based on manufacturing and stability data. Is that possible? What are the challenges, advantages, or risks involved, Dr. Kang?
So I think with the stability data, the door on extending how long a particular vial can be used has not been closed yet. But what you really want is to be absolutely sure that under every condition, not just the conditions that the company has used for stability data, but in real world use, what is the potency of the vaccines after being open for a period longer than you have had specified in the open vial. Now, those are studies that need to be conducted and need to be conducted in real life. I am not aware that this has been done as yet, but certainly before we do an extension, that's what would be required. Now, also thinking about open vial policies and what the challenges are and why you might want to restrict it to a shorter time period is because you will worry about two things. One is the worry of potency. If potency declines and the person is not getting as much of the vaccine as they think they are getting, it's not a full dose of the vaccine because there has been some degradation, then the problem is you haven't immunized a person. So that essentially becomes a wasted dose. The other thing that you worry about is in an open vial policy is the issue of contamination, whether you have inadvertently a safety concern. The longer that a vial is open, and open is a relative term, right? It's not like you're lifting the lid off and leaving the lid off, right? You are withdrawing from through a stopper. But nonetheless, because you've been in and out several times, you do worry about potential for contamination and you want to try and minimize that because contamination tends to be fungus or bacteria, and bacteria have a short generation time. So the longer your Vial is open, the greater your chance of introducing a contaminant and having it grow.
Thank you, Dr. Kang. A follow-up question on that. To our knowledge, COVID Shield Serum Institute has done the studies, and we believe it supports us with our open vial stability. If they were to submit that data, would that be NetVac or NTAGI? How does it work in terms of who makes the decisions, or is it confusing?
So NTAGI definitely does not make the decisions on the duration of the open vial policy. So as I mentioned, NTAGI's focus has really been around the introduction of new vaccines and not so much about changing of protocol. Much of this is decided within the immunization program about what is suitable or not. Occasionally, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare may constitute an additional committee to look at specific aspects of the immunization program. So, for example, when the rotavirus vaccine was being introduced, deciding on which were going to be the first states to introduce was there was a separate committee that was established to make the decision on which would be the first four states, and then which would be the next set of states and the next set of states. So these are ad hoc committees that are constituted for specific decisions on which the ministry might want an opinion.
Thank you. So there is one other aspect we've come across that some countries use maybe to reduce wastage, which is pre-filled syringes. We understand there's not a lot of studies to support this. WHO has not recommended it, but we see several countries are using pre-filled syringes as a way to minimize wastage, as a way to speed up the vaccination program. What are your thoughts on pre-filled?
It raises the cost of the immunization. So the basically what you're doing is packaging single doses as pre-filled syringes, and that makes it much more expensive to be able to deliver the vaccine, because those have to be kept separately, and also the design of a pre-filled syringe has to be such that until you have the needle on, you're not going to lose anything that is in the syringe.
So from an economic standpoint, it may not be viable for a country like India, where we have a very, very large scale immunization to be done.
Right now, the vaccines that we are using are quite expensive already. They are among the most expensive vaccines that we've ever had. None of our routine immunization vaccines, with the exception of HPV, have been this kind of price before.
But the cold space arrangement, the storage, is also a lot of space compared with the vials, because our cold CCPs and the cold chain system where we have storage of the vaccine is also, we have to see that one. If you give the pre-filled syringes like this, it occupies a lot of space also in that. One more thing, what madam is telling, the different temperature, that is also there. That is my, in my opinion, in the pre-filled syringes will be very expensive. Not only that, but the storage is also a problem.
So it's economic cost, but also from a logistic standpoint, you're saying it requires a lot more infrastructure than we are probably, we have or we can create. So thank you for that. So I will request the audience to submit questions. I think we're coming up to the last 10 minutes. So if you have any questions, you can type in the chat box. Meanwhile, I wanted to just summarize a few things that I thought were very interesting takeaways. That overall, for the India vaccination programs, we have built capacity over the years with the universal immunization program. We have actually addressed gaps that existed in some of the states. For instance, for cold chain capacities. So from a capacity standpoint, by the time COVID came around, it appears that India is well positioned to deliver on vaccines because of the capacities created over a long period of time. However, given that supply is an issue right now, and it is easing, but it is still an issue, we haven't really hit any problems at scale with COVID vaccination drive. But when we do overcome the supply issue, we think that vaccine hesitancy might come up again. Right now there's a demand supply gap, but when we get to 50-60% of the population vaccinated, we may again come up with the issue of hesitancy, because we have seen significant misinformation floating on WhatsApp groups, Twitter. In fact, some popular people have also started to say some things about vaccination, COVID vaccines, that are untrue and may be giving a lot of credibility though. So they make people question the vaccines, which is unfortunate. So there needs to be a campaign to address the hesitancy. Even though at the moment hesitancy is not an issue, but India needs to start thinking about messaging and communication to overcome vaccine hesitancy for the last 30-40% of the population when supply eases up. And regards to wastage, we seem to be doing better than the usual universal immunization program, where 10% is considered acceptable. But with COVID, we had higher wastage in the first few months. Dr. Geetha shared all the things that we're doing differently now to improve on that, which is fantastic. I am looking at a few questions from the audience. Give me a second. What if all the vaccines that are approved have the immunity for 8 to 12 months? And if we are not covering 30% of our population by end of 2021, the entire population who got vaccinated will have to go for the next round much before the rest of the population who needs first dose of vaccination. How is this going to be addressed considering current pace of vaccination and breaking upcoming COVID waves? Can we consider this wastage? Maybe not about wastage, but how do we address the immunity, Dr. Khan?
So I think this refers to the fact that you may be wasting your entire vaccination drive if you can't cover enough of the population in time to induce protection before the next wave hits. So I guess it's a fair way of defining wastage, but I think where we are today, one most scientific opinion is switching to expecting longer than 8 to 10 months of protection. It's possible that in some subpopulations, the elderly, the immunocompromised, you may need to revaccinate earlier. But in the bulk of the population, I think that primary immunization series will protect us for a reasonable period of time. So therefore, even if the program is slower, we will not be left unprotected when another wave comes.
We have questions, Dr. Geetha. How is each state managing such large-scale vaccine drive where almost 70% of the population has to be vaccinated with existing A&M ASHA workers, because we may not have been prepared for that level of scale? Dr. Geetha?
Because in the state of Andhra Pradesh, we used to have, there is no scarcity of the HR at all, because we are having ample of 42,575 ASHAs and 18,000 people of A&Ms, and there is a 13,000 of third A&Ms. We are having a huge army of people where we used to use their services. For that reason only, we are able to cover most of the population.
Got it. The next question for you, Dr. Geetha. With Aadhaar being mandatory, how is vaccine able to reach the underprivileged people, like people on the street and those without Aadhaar card?
Yes, that is the main challenge. We have got it when we have started that one also, that the people who are, we didn't have the privilege of the Aadhaar card, that also we have taken, and the government has taken a decision to show them not only the Aadhaar card, any evidence base, that is the other cards where they are having the ration card or like that also, we used to take the help of that, and we have vaccinated.
Thank you. The next question is, with all the restrictions in travel, physical training, how are frontline workers adequately trained? Are they used to more face-to-face training? And maybe Dr. Geetha mentioned you're adapting to virtual training.
Yeah.
How have people really adapted to it? Are they able to understand and deliver what's required?
For that reason, whenever we are having a training classes and work, which are especially run by the virtual, We used to conduct this a pretest for their understanding level, and after getting the training session also, we used to take them of the post-test also, like that. And not only that, whatever the questions, whatever the queries, if they arises, there are the people where we are having the coordination with the other people in the district. We used to clear their doubts, and practically we used to show them how to do it also practically also. Everybody should get vaccination. That is the only one message to protect. Not only that, even if they are vaccinated also, we don't know how, when we are expecting. We are also preparing to, in a state of Andhra Pradesh, every aspect of that, when really somebody is telling that the possible third wave comes, that how can we protect our people, our children from that also.
I think I echo Dr. Kang's sentiments, because I think that is the single most important thing that we should be doing now. But as a society, I think one of the things we have to think about is that we are global citizens and we have global responsibilities. So once we have made significant progress on immunizing our own people, given that we are one of the largest vaccine manufacturers in the world, we should be sharing our vaccines with the world to make sure that everyone everywhere has the ability to be protected from SARS-CoV-2. This is our responsibility, but it's, in a way, it's also a bit selfish, because it's only by suppressing disease in other parts of the world that we ensure that new variants don't arise, because variants will travel.
That's an excellent note to end on, Dr. Kang, in terms of we're not safe unless everyone is safe. WHO has been trying to say this, and we've seen a lot of countries are not yet sharing the vaccines, but some countries have started to. So hopefully we can get most global citizens vaccinated as soon as possible. Thank you so much for a wonderful and helpful conversation with a lot of insights. If we have more questions from the audience we're not able to ask today, we'll try and share them with offline. Thank you, Dr. Geetha, for taking the time,
thank
and
you.
Dr. Kang, for being back with us on COVID Connect. Thank you so much.